Hello, everyone, and thank you to and welcome to phylloseminar.org. This is a project supported by the Society of Systematic Biologists. Today is the first talk in a series of two talks on phylogenetic approaches to cancer. Today we will hear from Kamila Naxerova, and next we will hear from Roland Schwartz from Cambridge talking about phylogenetic quantification of intratumor heterogeneity. Kamila has been a PhD student and then a postdoctoral fellow at Harvard University and Massachusetts General Hospital since 2009, advised by Rakesh Jain. The focus of her work there has been to quantify and do phylogenetic analysis on human primary cancers and metastases. Before that, she got her master's degree in Heidelberg and has worked on various projects at the intersection of informatics and cancer, including looking for prognostic gene expression signatures in breast cancer and performing molecular characterization of lymphoma cell lines. Thanks for speaking, Kamila, and I'm looking forward to your talk.
All right. Thank you so much. Can you guys hear me?
Yep.
Okay. Perfect. I'm going to get started here. All right, so first of all, thanks very much to Eric for having me. And for me, this is a really great way for connecting with the phylogenetics community, which I'm not naturally part of, so to speak, because I'm a cancer biologist by training, and my interest in phylogenetics really developed as part of the interest to tackle one particular biological problem. And so the seminar today is definitely going to be very applied and biology-oriented, but hopefully still interesting for you guys. So what I would tell you about is our effort to understand in greater detail how metastatic cancer evolved in human patients. That is how cancer cell populations give rise to each other in order to form the large numbers of metastases, you know, that end up being the ultimate source of mortality in cancer patients. And so I'm going to get started with just explaining to you in a bit more detail why we care about evolutionary relationships between primary tumors and metastases. I'm going to try to illustrate this a little bit with a few real-world clinical examples. And then I'm going to give you a brief overview of the existing methods to study tumor lineage in human patients, and then spend the biggest part of the talk really introducing you to the new approach that we have taken to trace lineage. In this particular paper that I'll be presenting to you in colorectal cancer, with neutral genetic markers. Okay, so by way of introduction, this is something that really fascinated me when I first got into this topic. We have been interested in human cancer metastases for, you know, centuries, but we still don't really understand some of the basics of how metastases happen. There are actually two distinct, competing, and only partially overlapping models of how metastases evolve. And the first one is the traditional so-called linear progression model, which states that metastasis happens very late, when a primary tumor is large already, close to clinical detection, essentially. And that in these late stages of tumor development, genetically advanced cells leave the primary tumor, and then they travel to a central organ, for example, the lung or the liver, where they set up the first metastases. And then the primary tumor gets removed by surgery, and these metastases in the central organs then metastasize further to other locations, for example, here in this case, the bone or the liver or the brain. So that's one model. It's called linear progression, and it's been increasingly under debate whether this model is actually compatible with some of the growth rates of tumors we observe in the clinic. And particularly in the last 10 years, a second model has really come to the forefront, which paints a very radically different picture of how this happens in. That's the parallel progression model, which says metastasis happens early on. So before a tumor basically even starts invading the surrounding tissues, it already starts sending out individual cells to other organs. And these metastases then develop parallelly over decades with the primary tumor, so that they're basically detected clinically only a few years after the detection of the primary. And this model predicts that metastases basically derive independently all from the primary tumor as opposed to giving rise to each other. So basically the central questions that are still open with respect to metastatic progression is when exactly does metastasis occur? Is it early or is it late in tumor evolution? And then also by what route does metastasis occur? Do all metastases come directly from the primary tumor or do they give rise to each other in cascades? And you know, you might now be asking me, you know, what really is the clinical significance of these questions? And I'm going to give you a brief idea of that. So first of all, the lineage really shapes the genetic landscape of a neoplasm. So for example, if you have a case of linear progression where the metastases leave the primary very late, then you would expect that the primary and the metastases are pretty similar to each other genetically. And if you take a biopsy of the primary tumor, you will get, you know, a good idea of what the metastasis looks like in terms of genetics. And in the other case, in the parallel progression case, you really have to assume that the primary and the metastasis have been evolving separately for many, many years. So taking a biopsy from the primary and looking at the mutations found within it is probably not going to be a good approach for tailoring a therapy to treat metastases. Then also, you know, another important point actually that is often overlooked is that the lineage of a tumor really reflects the dynamics of its growth and dissemination. For example, a tumor that metastasizes very late may have a completely different biology than a tumor that metastasizes early on, that basically from the get-go has the ability to metastasize. And then last but not least, understanding the evolutionary relationships between, you know, primary and metastatic cancer can really inform better treatment strategies. And I'm going to give you a few examples of this. So first of all, how much do we really know about which tumor types metastasize early or late? Turns out, almost nothing. So here in this slide, I'm showing, you know, a few real examples from patients where metastases and primary tumors were compared on a genetic level to see how many alterations they share. And so here in this plot, this is a relatively old paper from 1997 looking at large-scale chromosomal aberrations in primary breast tumors and matched metastases. And the black bars show, you know, the number of changes that are distinct. So they're only present in the primary or in the metastasis, but not in both. And the white bars show the number of changes that are shared by both. And you can already appreciate, you know, that in some tumors, the primary and the metastasis tend to have, you know, a lot of genetic changes in common, but then other tumors have basically only private genetic changes that are present only in the metastasis or only in the primary. And here, this plot shows basically the same observation, just collected, the data collected with newer technologies. This is exome sequencing of pancreatic cancers, but you can still, you know, appreciate the same observation. In some patients, the primary and the metastases tend to be very similar, and in others, they tend to be very different. So for the clinician, you know, they really want to know when they start treating a patient, is the primary really representative of the metastatic lesions that they want to treat. This is here another example, which I think is a very powerful one and was actually part of, you know, the reason that motivated me to really look into this topic. You may have heard that just a few decades ago, if a woman presented with a large breast cancer, she would undergo a very radical surgery in which the entire breast was removed, sometimes along with the muscle underlying the breast, and then also her axilla would be dissected and all the lymph nodes taken out. And this is a surgery that really leads to a lot of morbidity, so lymphedema. It's a very radical surgery. And it was basically performed because the underlying idea was that a breast cancer will metastasize from the primary location to the lymph nodes that are in the axilla, and then from the lymph nodes to other places. And so it's basically a lineage argument that motivated this surgery, saying the lymph nodes are kind of an intermediate stop for the cancer cells that end up killing the patient. And it's only recently that we found out that this is actually not true. There was a big clinical trial in 2011 that showed that removing lymph nodes from the axilla probably doesn't do much to change outcome at all. And presumably, the metastases that are present in distant places, like the lung or the brain, are a completely different lineage than those that end up in the lymph nodes. So this is just to illustrate a little bit, you know, for why considerations of lineage and how exactly metastases give rise to each other really make a big difference for patients in the clinic. One more example here, which I also thought was pretty fascinating. So in many cases in the clinic for particular types of tumors, it's actually not always clear whether a growth represents a primary tumor or a metastasis. So here in this paper, there was a collection of patients that had a primary pulmonary squamous cell carcinoma, and then they had a head and neck squamous cell carcinoma, and then growths were discovered in the lungs. And the pathologists looking at those lung metastases were asked, do you think this is, you know, metastasis from the head and neck squamous cell carcinoma, or do you think this is a new primary? And it actually turned out that the clinical evaluation by the pathologist suggested that most of these new growths were metastases, and only six were second primaries, which are basically completely new tumors. But then when the same analysis was done on a molecular level, the results actually indicated that only 19 cases were metastases and the rest completely new tumors. And it turns out that the treatment for metastases versus new primary tumors is completely different, and there's a different prognosis for these patients. So, you know, in the clinic, I think there's still, you know, a lot of work to be done to really find good new ways of determining how different cancer cell populations within a patient are really related to each other. So how would we ideally go about this? Now, in these times when fancy new technologies are being, you know, used all over the place, it may come as a surprise to somebody who's not as involved in clinical work that lineage is really determined based on morphology in pathology departments as of today. So, for example, a patient presents with two tumors, they're both resected. How do we know whether one is a metastasis from the other or whether they present independent tumors? Well, the pathologist will look at the tumors under the microscope, will look at the morphology of the cells, and then based on that, basically make a diagnosis. Is this a primary tumor and it's metastasis, or are they two independent primary tumors? But it actually turns out that depending on where cancers grow and how they were treated, they can change morphologies pretty flexibly. So you can imagine that this is not a particularly safe way of determining lineage. So what would be other ways that, you know, that one could use to look at lineage relationships? So of course you could look at large scale copy number alteration, and I've already, you know, shown you a few examples of this, and there are a few really amazing papers that did this in clinical samples. So this is a Nature Medicine paper from 2009 in which the authors collected primary prostate cancers and multiple metastases from the same patient, and then they looked at genome-wide copy number alterations and compared them in all these samples in order to get a sense of how the different growths are related to each other. And this was a fascinating paper, except with the one caveat that if you're looking at large-scale alterations in the genome, like, for example, the loss of an entire chromosome arm, you can't really assume that these are selectively neutral changes, and you can't very easily exclude convergent evolution. So a particular, you know, change, for example, you know, amplification of chromosome 8q might be really beneficial for the cancer, so the change could arise independently multiple times. And so really looking at these big, large-scale genetic aberrations is probably not the most effective way of going about looking at lineage. More recently, there have been some very interesting examples of people looking at multiple tumor regions and multiple metastases using exome or whole genome sequencing. So this paper, which came out in the New England Journal in 2012, got a lot of attention. And here the authors basically took a renal cell carcinoma that was removed after short therapy and surgery, and they sampled multiple regions of this tumor as well as several metastases in this patient. And they performed exome sequencing on all of them, and based on the mutation information, they could construct something akin to a phylogenetic tree. In which they saw that there was an early branching event, that the metastases basically, you know, diverged from the lineage that presents the primary tumor fairly early on. So that was a very interesting example. Unfortunately, we don't have a whole lot of data like this. So this was one patient, and since then, you know, we've had data on a few more. But exome sequencing and even more whole genome sequencing is still relatively expensive, so not all that many labs, you know, can afford to do analyses at this level of detail. And then an additional constraint is also that in order to do exome or whole genome sequencing, you need informed patient consent because it generates potentially identifiable information. So consent for these types of analyses has to be collected prospectively from patients. And all the precious samples that are already present in pathology departments around the country of, you know, patients that you know, were treated 10 or 20 years ago, they can't be used for these types of analyses because there is no patient consent. So we became really interested in studying in more detail evolutionary relationships between primary tumors and metastases, kind of like you see in this tree here. In a large number of patients, and we were wondering, you know, given all these constraints, you know, what would be a good way of going about this? And so if you were to design this experiment, this lineage tracing experiment, humans from scratch, how would you want to go about it? So we thought, okay, so first of all, we would like to trace a permanent, that is a DNA sequence change. One could also look at epigenetic changes, but, you know, they tend to be a little more dynamic, so maybe it's safest to really look at DNA alterations. Then secondly, we would want for our lineage marker to be you know, in a neutral region of the genome so that it doesn't confer any selective advantages or disadvantages. We would want it to have a high mutation rate because we're looking at basically somatic evolution, so there aren't that many cell divisions that separate individual cell populations that are present in a patient. So it really needs to be a marker that mutates at a high rate so that we can gather enough information. Then ideally also the mutation rate would be coupled to cell division so that we basically, you know, can have a universal caliber that we can apply to the distances that we find between samples. And then, of course, also it would be good if, you know, the marker that we're looking at could be interrogated through some kind of high-throughput technique. So where would one find such a marker? It turns out, and I'm sure most of you know this, that unique or non-repetitive sequence in the genome mutates very slowly. So the rate is on the order of 10 to the minus 9 or 10 to the minus 10 per base, per division. So that's a very slow rate. In order to find enough in mutations to enable phylogenetic inference in the somatic setting, you really have to sequence a lot. You have to sequence, you know, big chunks of the genome in order to get enough information. But then there are also parts of the genome that are more repetitive. So particularly certain types of repeats mutate at a particularly high rate. And most of all, so-called mononucleotide GUIN repeats, which I'll call poly-G tracts from now on, they tend to be among the most mutable sequences in the genome. And they mutate at a rate that's about 1,000 times higher than unique sequence. So they really are enriched for somatic variation. So, you know, these are really our best bet. Finding mutations in these repeats is relatively straightforward. So they can basically be amplified through a PCR, you know, that uses fluorescent primers. So you can just amplify that piece of DNA that you're interested in, and then the length of the fragment can be analyzed by capillary electrophoresis. So that's basically you know, a fancy high-resolution gel. And when you have small insertion or deletion mutations, which are the type of mutations that typically happen in these tracts, so you know they wouldn't be base substitutions. It wouldn't be a change from, say, let's say G to A. They're typically small indels, and even one base pair insertions or deletions can be detected through this approach. So the idea to use polyguanine repeats for lineage tracing actually comes from, or at least some of you guys are from, namely Seattle. It was first published in a PNAS paper in 2006 by Stephen Salipanti and Marshall Horowitz. And what they did is, you know, they took a single cell, they let it evolve in culture, and then they sampled single cell progeny at a whole number of these polyguanine repeats, and they tracked mutations that had happened during this proliferation in culture. And they were able, you know, using a fairly small panel of these markers to recreate the correct phylogenetic tree that they set up in culture. So when I really got interested in looking at phylogenetic relationships between, you know, primary tumors and metastases, I didn't really know what would be a good way of going about this. And, you know, after I read this paper, I thought, wow, this is a very interesting approach. Let's try and see whether we can use this to study how cancer evolved in human patients. So the setting when looking at human cancer samples is a little different from what these guys did here. So these were single cell analyses. Basically, you start out with a single cell, you let it evolve in culture, and then you sample more single cells at the end. So it's a little different when we look at patient samples, because there we can't analyze single cells. We have DNA that comes from so-called formalin-fixed and paraffin-embedded tissues. So these are surgical samples that in the hospital already, you know, get put into chemicals and then put into a wax block. So the DNA in those samples is not a very good quality, and looking at single cells really is not an option. So we really have to look at populations of thousands and millions of cells. And so that setting is a little different from looking at the genotype that you find in one particular cell. So I just want to take a little bit of time to kind of show you what it means to look at somatic variation in the bulk setting, in the bulk cell setting. And to that end, I'm just going to explain a little bit of how somatic variants get propagated during organogenesis, during the development of the human, and then and later on during carcinogenesis. So let's just try to think of how, you know, mutations get propagated during development. So we're starting out with a zygote. So this is at the very beginning of development, and we're going to be, you know, tracing four hypothetical G tracts, and we're going to set their length at zero in the zygote and basically record insertion mutations as plus one and deletion mutations as minus one. So here we have the zygote. It starts dividing, it starts proliferating, And then during every cell division, you know, there's a certain probability that any one of these G tracts will undergo either a insertion mutation here, plus one, or a deletion mutation. So now you can imagine that during development, these cells are dividing, but they're not necessarily staying put. So, you know, the progeny of this cell don't necessarily stay in its immediate surroundings. They're all swirling around and mixing all the time. And by the time, you know, you have a fully formed adult human being, if you sample any given tissue, it will contain cells from all branches of this organismal cell tree. And because the technology that we're using in order to detect these mutations is not digital, we're looking at a fairly low sensitivity that we have to detect mutations. So you can imagine through the mixing, every single cell will have many mutations that it acquired, but at any given locus, those will probably average out. So, for example, you know, at this particular G tract, these two cells that have a common ancestor, they have a mutation, but all the other ones don't. And so, basically, if you take, you know, big polyclonal chunks of tissue, let's say from the kidney, from the brain, from muscle, and you look at the length of poly G tracts in these tissues, you will always get back the zygote genotype. And I've actually done this in human tissue. I've really tested it, and it's true. So polyclonal tissues have this zygote genotype. The situation changes quite a bit during carcinogenesis, because there you have one single cell that basically has all the mutations it inherited throughout development, and it will start proliferating, and it will give rise to a population of cells that remain locally bound in the vicinity. They remain close to each other within the tumor. And when you sample this population, you will basically be able to pick up all the mutations that were present in the founder cell and that became clonally dominant during tumor genesis. And the same happens during the development of a metastasis. And so when you compare normal tissues here to primary tumors to metastases, all of a sudden, through these clonal expansions, one gets the power to detect these potentially, you know, lineage informative mutations.
So can I just ask a quick question?
Sure.
So there's lots of these tracts, right?
Yes, that's right.
Are you just amplifying specific ones, or I just would be nervous that if you're aggregating, then there's some aggregation effect.
Yeah, so we're genotyping. I'm going to show you in a few slides later. We're looking at 20 tracts for the purposes that I'll be showing you today. We've since looked at more, but we're looking at 20 tracts, and they will all be basically, you know, amplified from the same sample, more or less. So, you know, you take a piece of the tumor, and then you PCR amplify 20 distinct tracts that you then look at.
But wait, those could be from 20 different cells.
No, so this is the kind of the bulk cell problem. They're from millions of cells.
Okay, well.
Right. So basically, that's why in any normal tissue you can't really detect any mutations in normal tissue, yeah. Because exactly you have these aggregation effects. You have millions of cells mingling together, and each one of them will have a different genotype, so they will average out. So the beauty of doing this in cancer is that, you know, in the cancer, if you sample only tumor tissue, and we're very careful about this, then you will have a population that all share the genotype of this ancestral cell. And you will be able to pick them up, even though you're looking at millions of them. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I mean, it still does seem, though, that, like, so for instance, if we have one population that has a little bit of two mutations, averaged out with some non-mutated cells, and then that's going to get conflated with twice as many cells that have just a single mutation.
That's absolutely right, and that's I'm going to, you know, talk about this a little bit in the end. That's a caveat. You can't look at subclonal mutations. You can really only see mutations that are present in almost all cancer cells. Actually, some of the sensitivity analyses that the group in Seattle did suggested that about 40 to 60% of cells in your sample have to have the mutation in order for it to become detectable. If there's anything below this, you can't see. So we're basically, you know, talking about mutations that are present in a majority of the cells in your sample.
Okay. Thanks. Does that make sense? Yep.
Okay, perfect, thanks. Yeah, and this is a really important point because it will inform all the things I'll show you later. So yeah, thank you for asking this question. Okay, so we were interested in using these poly-G mutations to look at the evolution of colorectal cancer. And why colorectal cancer? Reasons are fairly simple. So first of all, it's a common cancer type. So in our pathology department, at least, there are sufficient numbers of cases that are available for this cancer. And even more importantly, in this cancer type, lymphatic and distant intra-abdominal metastases, for example, to the ovaries or to the liver are often resected. So that's actually not always the case. In many cancer types, there is no real survival benefit to resecting metastases, and so these tissues are not available. So in colorectal cancer, we really did have access to all the appropriate samples. So we first wanted to know, can we even find these poly-G mutations in our cancer samples? Because nobody had really done this in cancer before, and you know, we didn't really know how many of these mutations we could even find in the tumors. So we started out by doing an analysis of 22 tumor normal pairs from randomly selected patients that basically, you know, were selected from a pool of patients that had surgery for colorectal cancer at MGH and had at least 3 lymph node metastases and or distant metastases. And for these 22 cases, we basically took a piece of normal tissue from that patient and a sample from the cancer and genotyped at these G tracts. And so practically what that looks like is, you know, I walk down to the pathology department, I get a little piece of wax where the tumor is embedded. I then dissect the tumor tissue where it's most homogeneous to make sure that there's no contamination of normal cells. I extract DNA from these samples, and then by PCR, we look at the length of 20 G tracts in both the normal and the tumor sample. And these PCR products then get then analyzed in by capillary electrophoresis, or as I said before, a fancy gel, to see whether we can detect any length differences. And so here are the results of that initial screen. So here basically you see the patient ID, so these are the 22 distinct patients, and here on the y-axis I'm plotting the percentage of mutated loci we found in each patient. So how many of the 20 G tracts that we looked at were mutated. And you can appreciate that, you know, there's a pretty large distribution of mutation frequency across these patients. So some of them had almost all or all loci that we looked at mutated, so there was a distinct difference between the tumor and the normal. And then there were some patients that didn't have any mutations at all. So we looked at all kinds of factors that could explain this variation in mutation rates. And the first one that, you know, really was quite obvious was the presence of microsatellite instability. So microsatellite instability is a known molecular defect in a certain percentage, between 15 and 20 of colorectal cancers, where proteins that are responsible for doing DNA mismatch repair are mutated or otherwise lost. And in these cancers, the mutation rate of repeats, but also of other sequences, goes up quite a bit. So, you know, we saw in our cohort that patients that were diagnosed with this particular molecular defect really did have the most mutations. So that made a lot of sense. But then there was still, you know, a very large number of patients that didn't have microsatellite instability that still showed an abundance of mutations. And, you know, we were wondering what could really explain this variability. So, interestingly, what we found when we looked very closely at this is that the mutation frequency in tumors is correlated with the age of the patient. So the younger the patient at diagnosis, the fewer mutations we can find in his or her tumor. And this is excluding those that have microsatellite instability because a distinct mutational mechanism is operational in those. So that actually made a lot of sense. If you think back to what I explained a few slides ago, that when you look at the tumor genotype, you basically get a readout of all the mutations that were already present in its founder cell. So colonic stem cells, they divide very often, perhaps even daily, during the lifetime of a patient. And during each division, they accumulate mutations. And so, you know, when a patient that is close to 80 years old develops a cancer that is derived from one of those colorectal stem cells, they will basically have a higher baseline mutational rate than the stem cells of a young person. So that made a lot of sense. But then, much more surprisingly, what we found is also that tumors that are high grade, which, you know, in clinical jargon means that they're undifferentiated and aggressive. So when a pathologist looks at a tumor sample, they classify the tumor based on how similar the cells are to normal colon cells. And high grade tumors, basically, what that means is the cells show very little resemblance to the normal glands that one would find in the colon. And these tend to be the most aggressive cancers with the worst prognosis. And what we found was that these tumors actually had much less mutations, much fewer mutations than those tumors that were so-called well-differentiated or more indolent forms of colon cancer. So that was very surprising, and we looked at potential stromal contamination in both these groups and found that it was no different, so, you know, that couldn't explain this highly significant difference we saw in the mutation rates. And so we're now looking in much more detail into why this is potentially happening. But one hypothesis is that the high-grade tumors derive from a distinct stem cell population in the colon that is more quiescent, that doesn't divide every day, that's basically more primitive or more embryonic, and that these tumors are therefore more aggressive and more stem cell-like. That was an interesting observation that we found, and we're really, really interested in following up on this. Okay, so this was, you know, all kind of the overview of the more general things we found by looking at the entire cohort. So now to the main objective that we had in this project. We wanted to see how metastatic cancer evolved and whether we can understand by looking at these polygene mutations how different tumor cell populations in one patient are related to each other. So I'm going to now just walk you through a few examples, a few case studies, and show really what the technique can do. So this patient, he was a 66-year-old male, and he had two synchronous carcinomas that were resected in his colon. So there was one tumor kind of at the beginning of the colon, the so-called cecum, and then he had another tumor which was at the end of the colon, the so-called sigmoid colon. And these tumors were about the same size, and they were histologically similar, so it wasn't necessarily clear whether one was a metastasis of the other or whether they were really independent. And then also there was a lymph node metastasis that was in the vicinity of this tumor that we were able to look at. And 1 year after this initial surgery where these two tumors were resected, the patient returned to the clinic, and he had a liver metastasis that was also resected. So this was basically, you know, a really good place to start to ask some very basic questions, namely, are these two tumors independent? Does this lymph node metastasis really derive from the tumor that it's next to? And then, most importantly, which one of these tumors gave rise to the growth in the liver? And when I give this talk to biologists, I basically, you know, skim over how exactly we arrived at the answers to these questions. So I will show is basically, you know, a heat map that, and I say, well, we looked at, you know, multiple normal samples, and then these are all the samples from the different tumors. And we looked at 20 G tracts and here in each row, I'm showing one of the gene track that had at least one mutation in one of the samples. In different mutation states are shown in different colors. Gray squares signify genotypes that are the same as in the normal polyclonal samples. And then I will say we took this mutation data and we converted it into a phylogenetic tree. And then I will talk about, you know, what kind of biological insight we derive from this. But so in this particular setting, where I am fortunate enough to have phylogenetics experts who can maybe give me some good advice on how to do all of this, I'll do this in much more detail, and I'll actually explain all the steps that we undertook in our analysis. So I'll just walk you through it. So basically what happens, and if you know, remember, each one of these G-tracts we can look at by looking at its length through this capillary electrophoresis approach. So basically we will take one sample, which maybe is like a piece of normal uninvolved colon, and then we will take one sample from one tumor area and another sample from another tumor area. For example, this could be tumor area 1, this could be tumor area 2. And we collect the length of our PCR products. And so it turns out, because these G-tracts are so mutable, when you amplify them via PCR, you don't get one fragment corresponding to the length of your amplicon, but you get a whole distribution which corresponds to errors that the polymerase is making during the PCR process. And we believe that, we and others really believe that the highest intensity peak, this peak here, corresponds to the true length of the fragment. But in order to score them, you really have to take into account the entire distribution. So what happens is that I export the height of these peaks, in these little matrices, where I'm like, okay, so I have a particular intensity at 180 base pairs. And so this basically just corresponds to the shape of this distribution. Depending on some variability in the PCR, the actual intensities of these peaks can vary from reaction to reaction, but the overall shape never changes. So that's very important. So the way we compare these is we calculate pairwise correlation coefficients between all samples. And so, for example, a sample that will have a very similar genotype will have a high correlation coefficient, and then a sample that is very different will have a low correlation coefficient. So we basically score the similarity of these distributions by calculating correlations. And then we create a distance matrix based from all these pairwise correlations across all samples, and we use hierarchical clustering to put them into groups. So here I'm showing you like a real world example where there's one cluster here that corresponds to all the normal samples. So for example, uninvolved colon, uninvolved liver, and they're all the same, and they correspond to the normal genotype. And then there are other clusters that correspond to samples that share a particular mutation. So for example, this cluster here has an insertion mutations of two G's. The sample here has lost one G, and this one has one G added also. So then the tree is cut at a height that we basically figured out through trial and error, and we can assign a mutation status to each sample based on where it lies in this tree. And so this is basically how we construct this heat map. So the gray squares, they correspond to samples that have a normal genotype, and then different mutations are indicated in different colors here. So in order to build trees, what we do is a very, very simple approach, and I'm very interested to hear, whether maybe you guys have some ideas of like how to do this in a more sophisticated or maybe even more useful way. But basically what we've been doing so far is we create the mutation data matrix, as I just explained to you. Then we calculate pairwise distances between samples, for example, between the liver metastasis and the primary tumor across all samples, and we're using a so-called equal or not distance, which basically says for each marker, the distance is increased by one if the genotype is different, and if it's the same, the distance is zero for that particular marker. Why do we use equal or not, as opposed to really putting in the mutation information, so how many G's have been added or deleted? The reason is that we don't really know what the probability of mutation of a particular tract is, so the mutations don't necessarily happen in a stepwise manner. You can have basically an addition of two base pairs during one replication event, or the deletion of one, but we don't really know very well what these probabilities are. So in order to calculate the distances, we're basically treating them all the same. If something is different, it increases the distance by one. If it's not, it doesn't. But we don't really try to interpret the magnitude of the mutation.
But let's say, so but how do you decide whether you have these two histograms effectively, so how do you decide if they're the same or not?
So here at this point, how do I decide whether they're the same or not?
Yeah.
So this is kind of what I was talking about a few slides back. So I basically have two distributions. I first, calculate all the pairwise correlation between all these peaks, and then they get clustered. And then the clusters basically determine whether they're different or not. So for example, here, these are all PCR replicates. You see that all the PCR replicates for one particular sample, for example, sample R and sample
G. Okay. I'm sorry. Yeah, I get it.
How does it make sense? Okay, thank you. Yeah, this is a bit complicated, and I hope at least roughly, it comes across. But yeah, here at this stage, we determine whether they're really different or not based on this clustering.
But basically, essence though is like, do they always look like this, where it does seem like there is this really clear clustering? Because if there is, I'm.
Yeah, actually, and that's the beauty of it. It really always looks like this. If you do the experiment well and you run your PCRs, in many replicates in a clean way, that's really what it looks like. Because these mutations, they're very reproducible. So all, if there is a difference, you will basically see it in every PCR. And that took a long time experimentally to set the protocol up in a way that it becomes so reproducible. But this clustering that I'm showing is really reproducible. That's what it looks like. Okay. So that's right. So we create the mutation data matrix, and then without assigning any meaning to the magnitude of the mutations, we create a distance matrix from them. And in this particular paper, we use neighbor joining to build our trees for the simple reason that I don't think we can assume that the evolution rates in different lineages are the same. So some samples, some tumors might proliferate at a very high rate. For example, metastases tend to proliferate maybe more vigorously than parts of the primary tumor. So we don't really know how fast mutations accumulate in different lineages. So we're using neighbor joining to do this, and we assign confidence values by bootstrapping 1,000 times. And so this is the tree that results from this type of effort. So basically, we started out with questions: are these two guys independent transformations or not? It looks like that they are. They actually share one mutation, but because there are only so many insertions or deletions that can happen in one particular locus, I'd be tempted to say that this one mutation is probably present in both by chance, even though I don't know for sure. But they're definitely in very clearly segregated evolutionary branches. And then most importantly, the lymph node metastasis that is in close proximity to this tumor here, clearly belongs to the same evolutionary branch. And the liver metastasis also derives from this tumor. So this guy here is not the culprit. He didn't metastasize, but this tumor here did. Okay, so in the remaining time, I'm going to show you a few more examples. This very shortly, we also, you know, looked at other ways of reconstructing the phylogenies. So down here I have a few details, but basically all the Bayesian phylogenies that we looked at gave us essentially the same results as the neighbor joining approach. So here this is the one tumor, this is the other tumor with the lymph node and the liver metastasis deriving from it. So really from a biologic perspective, these gave the same results. I'm just going to show you few more examples. So this patient was an 83-year-old woman, and she had a tumor in her colon and also two metastases to the ovaries. And so we did the same thing. This tumor had a lot of mutations. So here I'm showing you the heat map again. And if you're using this to create a phylogenetic tree, as I showed you, what you will see is that the primary tumor is much older than the metastases. So it's highly diversified. There were some samples, for example, PT5 versus primary tumor sample 6 that had no mutations in common. So it was an extremely diversified tumor. And the metastases really represented one fairly rapid, probably clonal expansion, because they didn't diversify at all. So all the samples from the metastases looked very similar to each other. And interestingly, very similar to two particular areas from the primary tumor, and it's likely that the metastatic clone that gave rise to the metastases was resident in one of these areas. And so this phylogenetic tree definitely is consistent with a model of linear progression. So basically the primary tumor evolving for a long time on its own, and then in late stages, close to clinical detection, giving rise to these metastases. Either both metastases came from these areas of the primary tumor, or they also could have given rise to each other. Again, same results with the Bayesian approach. So maybe one more example that I'll quickly show you before we run out of time. It was a 48-year-old woman, and she also had a colon tumor and a metastasis to the lymph nodes, and another very large metastasis to the ovary. And so these are the mutation data and converted to phylogenetic tree. This was a really interesting example for us, because it showed that, so first of all, there were a lot of mutations that distinguished the primary from the metastasis, which really is more in line with the parallel progression model that I mentioned to you in the beginning, where the primary tumor and the metastases evolved separately for a good amount of time, because they really had a distinct mutational profile. And interestingly, the lymph node metastasis was actually very similar to the primary tumor, suggesting either that it metastasized later than these guys here, or maybe that cells from the primary tumor were continually draining into the lymph nodes and therefore represented, a current sample from the primary tumor and were therefore indistinguishable from it. We also found some examples of genetic homogeneity. So here, a patient had a very large cancer that had metastasized to all kinds of different parts of his abdomen, so very large metastatic cancer. And we looked at many, many different parts of it, but they were all more or less indistinguishable from each other, interestingly. So that really implies that this cancer grew very rapidly, so there was no time for regional diversification. And we're now trying to figure out whether this type of genetic homogeneity in different parts of the tumor really bodes for a bad outcome. So if these are the worst cancers that grow so quickly that there is no time to acquire private mutations in different parts. This is basically it here. I just had some general thoughts, which I think I can skip. And I'll just I'll end with a short summary. So this type of polygenic profiling first really invented in Seattle, and we kind of took it on and adapted it for the study of human tumor evolution. I think it's a powerful technique. So 3 to 5 multiplex PCR reactions per tumor sample are enough to generate all the data that I showed you today and all the trees that you saw today. It's suitable for you know, the sort of specimens that get routinely collected in the clinic, so it doesn't require any special handling. You can just, you know, go to a hospital and pick up the specimens that they already have, and it will work. And we also found that other cancer types, other than colorectal cancer, have these polygene mutations, so this can also be done in other cancers. The sensitivity, unfortunately, is relatively low, so we already spoke about this when Eric asked his question. About 40 to 60% of the cells in the sample have to have a mutation, otherwise the technique won't pick it up. And then another good question that Eric raised was what happens, you know, if you have a mixing of different cell populations. This is a similar caveat to this one. So, you know, if you have two tumor cell populations and one has a mutation and the other doesn't, and they're mixing, it can, you know, make for very kind of challenging genotypes to interpret. And of course, there is no information on causative coding mutations, you know, that could be used for treatment purposes. So thank you so much, Eric, for inviting me. Definitely really, really fun, my first online seminar. And of course, to all my collaborators at the MGH and Jesse Salk from the University of Washington, who was also very involved in this work and contributed a lot.
All right, thank you very, very much. That was a very interesting talk, and I mean, being at a cancer center myself, I do enjoy thinking about, okay, how can we actually get some perspective on things that people often just sort of model in a sort of vague way?
Yeah, yeah.
I guess that's sort of my first thing is, like, seems like having having these sorts of things interact with the sorts of models that people talk about progression to cancer and metastases, I mean, that seems really interesting. I mean, it's sort of like once you get a collection of trees, how can you start testing these hypotheses? I mean, have you guys thought about that at all, I guess is all I'm saying.
Yeah, so it's a very good question, and it's also something our reviewers ask us when we submitted the paper. So I think in order to start testing specific biological hypotheses, first of all, you have to collect, you know, a very large amount of samples that all are very homogeneous in the type of clinical scenario that they represent. And I'll give you one example, which is a project that I'm working on right now. So there was one patient that I showed you in which the distant metastasis to the ovary had a different genotype from the lymphoid metastasis that was close to the primary tumor. So this was very interesting to us. Is this, you know, more general phenomenon that lymphoid metastases are more closely related to the primary tumor than distant metastases? Does it mean that there's a different metastatic process underlying the two? And in order to test this, you really need a very homogeneous patient population that all have this exact same scenario. They have primary tumor, an associated lymphoid metastasis, and distant metastasis at the same time. And then when you collect patients that all have these three particular kinds of samples and you you know, you look at 20, 30, or 40 of them, you can really start you know, talking about percentages. So, for example, 80% of patients with lymphoid metastases are more closely related to the primary tumor than the distant metastases. I think that's the way to go. I think maybe not the ideal way to go, but I think that's the best solution that I can envision right now, having very homogeneous patient populations and basically answering the same question every patient and then just expressing, right, in percentages what kind of metastatic behavior is most prevalent.
Right, because it, yeah, like you say, it'll probably depend very much on tumor type and so on.
Yeah, I think so. So in breast cancer, presumably, if one is to believe the big literature that's already out there, I definitely do I think the metastases tend to be much more different than, for example, in colorectal cancer, where the metastases are often, you know, liver metastases that come to the liver from the colon in a straightforward way through the portal circulation. So it really depends a lot on the tumor type and the anatomic relationship.
Right. So speaking of phylogenetics, I didn't know the Salaponte paper. When you said standard model of, you said it was reconstructed with a gamma blah 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 and standard.
Yeah. Okay.
You know what does that actually mean?
So do you want me to go back to this? I can actually probably tell you. So I basically used for the Bayesian reconstruction. I used the same parameters that they had already figured out worked for these particular type of G repeat genotypes. And the parameters are, what they used the so-called morphological or standard discrete model in Mr. Bayes with, I think in their case, in a fixed Dirichlet distribution. And then the rates were gamma distributed, and they used unordered characters again to, because we don't really know whether like a +2 insertion is further away phylogenetically than, you know, a +1 insertion. So that's the approach they took to the Bayesian reconstruction. And I didn't know very little about Bayesian phylogeny, so I basically took that at face value, and I used the same approach, and gave me the same result as the neighborhood.
Well, if that's true, that you wouldn't expect sort of +2s to occur at any different distribution than +1s, then I guess that's a reasonable thing to do. What is the dynamic range? Like, how big and small of differences?
So they can be up to, I would say, in microsatellite stable tumors, up to maybe 4 base pairs insertions or deletions. That's the biggest I've seen. Once you get DNA mismatch repair defects, which is, you know, a whole different class of tumors, they can have huge changes, like, you know, 20 base pairs can just vanish. But in normal tumors, that's a paradoxical way to think, not normal tumors, but in those that don't have DNA mismatch repair, they tend to be fairly small. So it's 1, 2, 3 base pair deletions or insertions is typically what you'll see.
That's funny that you brought up mismatch repair insertions, because I know that for just sort of general point mutations, there are sort of mutator phenotypes that occur in cancer.
Yeah,
so you ever see, I mean, so you see this switch happening sometimes that the mismatch repair is gone and then boom.
And then all but hell breaks loose. That's right. And when we look at those tumors, the G-tracts, the genotypes of the G-tracts are all over the place. And it's a very broad distribution. Basically, meaning that there are lots of different alleles present in the tumor, and it's mutating away. So those are challenging ones to work with.
I mean, the only thing that's really bothering me is this conflation thing about like frequency. But I guess you're, if you do assume that, sorry, the frequency of observing a certain type of clone versus how many mutations it has, and that, I mean, that seems like a challenging thing. I mean, you can imagine doing something where you ran a bunch of experiments where you sort of take known mixtures of tracts of different lengths, and you sequence them, and you look at their histograms and try to see, is there some sanity to it? Is there something that you can learn? But maybe that's too complicated.
No, not necessarily. I think, yeah, that's definitely, it's a big problem that you basically have to take these distributions at face value, don't really know what is the frequencies of cells, you know, contributing to this distribution. So for example, let's say if you compare tumor to normal and you see a 1 base pair deletion, it could be that all cells have a one base pair deletion, or it could be, you know, maybe that there are, 50% of tumor cells with a larger deletion and another, you know, set of them with a slightly smaller one, and they're basically overlapping to give you something that looks like all cells have a one base pair deletion. I'm not sure whether this is actually the correct example. But you can, you can't really deconvolve what it means. You can only observe that there's a difference, but you don't really know what are the facts on the ground that generate this difference. That's definitely a disadvantage. But again, you know, because it's so easy to generate these data, and at least the results we've got so far make so much sense, from a biological perspective, I think that even though for some markers maybe you get kind of murky results, if you look at enough of them, it will even out.
So Bastien Bousseau asks, how many loci?
So yeah, the more the better, I guess. So for the cases that I just showed you, these 20 markers were in most cases enough to, you know, create at least an initial tree that had reasonable confidence values, reasonable bootstrap values. So for those cases, if you now doubled or tripled the number of markers, how much better, you know, would you get? How much more biological information would you really collect? Maybe not that much more, but then there are other cases like the patient that I showed you where all samples were the same. You know, there it's quite possible that if you expand your panel, you look at more, you'll get more information. So I think it really depends on the mutation rate in that particular patient and on how different the samples are, how many tracks you need to, you know, generate answers that make statistical and biological sense in a way. We now have a panel that's bigger, 40 markers instead of 20, so and that's good, but it could be even bigger.
Yeah, it's interesting though. I mean, I'm not sure exactly in what sense he meant this question, but you're basically treating each locus as what we think of as a site. So typically when you're doing phylogenetics, you have like each of the sites and you're looking at the mutations of that site, but you're looking at a sort of amplicon by amplicon array where each one is one site in our terminology. And sometimes, so in phylogenetics, sometimes it's important to differentiate between sort of mutations that happen in one gene versus another, and sometimes the trees don't agree and so on. Like, so it's possible that he's thinking about that, but I guess, I mean, one thing that I guess you could think about in terms of that is, do you see, say, a difference between chromosomes and within a single chromosome? Like,
not really. And I think the reason for that is that, you know, we take a lot of care not to use any tracks that are encoding regions, so they're all neutral. As far as we know, I mean, we're always discovering new things about DNA, so maybe one day we'll figure out that they're not neutral at all. But there are non-coding regions or in introns. All the ones that were in exons, I disregard. So in that sense, and because the sequence is always the same, there are these G repeats, I think that the different loci are probably very comparable to each other. And if the mutation rate at each locus is not the same, I mean, the longer the track, the more it will mutate. I guess maybe it would be interesting to incorporate this in the model of, like, how long is the track, what's the happy initial likelihood that, you know, it will mutate, but I haven't done that so far.
He also asks, I think, an interesting question. Do you think you could use the same approach to get a tree of normal development by sampling different organs and tissues?
Yeah, so I would love to do that, first of all. I think that's so interesting. We still know, particularly about human development, we know so little. And really looking more closely at lineages, I think, will be a big thing in biology in the future. You would have to do this on a single cell level. So as I explained to you earlier, if you take these bulk tissues, so basically, I've actually done this. I went to autopsy and I collected different tissues from the same person, and I took samples from them and genotyped them, but you can't find any mutations because all the normal cells are intermingling, as I explained earlier, and they're averaging each other out. So you need a clonal population in order to detect mutations. And kind of by definition, clonal populations are neoplasms. It doesn't happen in a normal body that, unless maybe, in some instances where you have like an immune cell response at one particular, lymph node, let's say. But in normal tissues, this doesn't happen. The cells come from all different lineages. And you have stromal cells and fibroblasts and immune cells and epithelial cells, and they're all, their most recent common ancestor is the zygote, and they're all mingling. So unfortunately, unless you are willing to go to the single cell level, this is still tough. But I would, once the technology improves, maybe that will be possible, and that will be really good.
So, but I guess I'm curious about that too. So when you say when technology improves, what do you see? It still sounds kind of labor intensive to me, who doesn't do anything in the lab. I mean, you sort of have to do all this cloning, and then you have to run them out, and so on. Is this really going to be easier in the long run than just doing some more fancy analysis?
You mean by doing, for example, whole genome sequencing?
Well, yeah. I mean, just or at very least, just amplifying your regions with a multiplex primer and then sequencing them.
Yeah. So actually, my colleague Jesse Salk, who's from the University of Washington and part of this paper, I think he's looking more into how to sequence each repeat so you can really scale it up more and make it more simple. It's difficult. These regions can't really be sequenced easily. So it's because they are so mutable. They are really regular sequencing technologies have trouble with them.
But I guess that's another interesting question. I mean, what about just PCR? I mean, does PCR with a big fat G region in the middle?
Yeah, so that's what we're doing right now. So we're just PCRing them, and we're looking at how long they are. That's kind of the state of the problem. Is that doing this with single cells is very difficult.
Right, so, but I mean, does PCR get messed up by having a bunch of G's in a row?
Yes, and that's exactly right, and that's this distribution that I showed you. So if you did PCR on a unique piece of DNA, you would get one fragment. In this case, you're getting this whole histogram.
I see. Okay.
And that's because there are so many mistakes that the polymerase makes. Ideally, I think it's actually not that labor intensive. You're PCRing, you're putting it in a sequencer to determine the length, and that's the end of the story. The problem is that if you have only single cells, you can't amplify these loci very reliably based on just one piece of DNA as a template. And so that's why you have to go do whole genome amplification or things that potentially will mess with your results and introduce artifacts. So that's I think that's what I meant when I said when our technology improves, maybe at some point we'll have the technology to look at single cells and really look at the length of the few repeats in single cells. Maybe when we have nanopore sequencing, but so far, we haven't been able to do that.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I have definitely asked too many questions. I'll wrap things up, and let's see. So I believe the next seminar is going to be on Thursday, June 19th, at least here in this time zone at 9 in the morning. So that will also be about cancer. Looking forward to seeing that from Roland Schwartz from Cambridge, who's part of Nick Goldman's group, I believe. Okay, thanks.